Welcome back to another episode of Podward State. I'm one of your hosts, Sam Brungo, joined here by my friend Grace Cunningham. Grace, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. We are here for our season 5 finale. It's been a cool season.
Yeah, went by very fast.
It did. So this is our 13th episode?
I think so, 13.
This is less than we normally have because we only did one a week. But
they were quality, though.
These episodes were awesome. We had some new things. We added headlines.
Mm-hmm.
We added football coverage.
Mm-hmm.
Song. We added plenty of folks to the team.
Mm-hmm.
Quick little shout out. We got Connor Krause with the football coverage. Charlie Pegler. We got Will with the football coverage. He was on already. Stutz, our editor. And obviously, sound technician, associate producer, Jordan.
Missing
Mansberger.
Shannon.
We're missing Shannon Smith. Anyone want to pretend they're Shannon? We can have Stutz Photoshop her face on. That was my imitation of Shannon.
That was a good impersonation of Shannon.
But anyways, yeah, we had a cool, a lot of cool conversations. Looking forward to season 6.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully you guys stick around for season 6. Season 6 is Grace's show.
That's scary. Oh. I feel like that was like telling.
Oh, shit.
I kill Podward State.
Season
like
6 is your show.
Months.
Yeah. I'm going to let you do everything.
Okay.
Anyways, Mike Poorman on this episode. Stick around. He says some cool stuff. Some crazy stuff. Mike's the best, so appreciate him. We have Mike after the break. Joining us now, we have Penn State professor, Penn State beat writer for many a decade, Mike Poorman. Mike, welcome to the show. How are you?
I'm good. It's good to be here, Jack.
For our listeners who don't know what you're talking about, what is that?
Well, we got Will and Grace, and Sean Hayes played Jack. So that's you.
There you go.
That's a dad joke. First, anyway, keep score of the dad jokes? Okay.
This is dad joke number 2. One came before we started recording. So for our listeners who don't know who you are, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. My main job is I direct alumni relations for the Belisario College of Communications. Run boards, events, mentoring programs. Things like that. Get alumni involved. But I cover football for statecollege.com. I'm getting my master's at Penn State, almost done, history of philosophy of sport. I'm supposed to be writing my master's thesis this semester, but not going very well. Let's see. I used to be, for 6 years, I was a faculty advisor for field hockey. I teach COM 170, Intro to the Sports Industry.
Which would you say is how most people know you?
Most people on campus, but a lot through football. And, that's a lot of other stuff. I wear a lot of hats. I'm on the board for the Center for Sports and Study of Sports and Society. My worlds kind of overlap. I think that's the best thing. My worlds overlap. It's like this guy's going to be in class next
Indeed.
Semester we had class together, that's the deal.
So you graduated from Penn State in
82, dual degree journalism, poli-sci.
Okay.
Really? That's my minor.
Oh, it's a great minor. I love it. Terrific classes.
Where are you from and how did you choose Penn State as your school?
I'm from a town called Palmyra. We share a traffic signal with Hershey, which is our claim to fame. I originally went to a small college called Muhlenberg in Allentown. I ran cross country there. I hated Penn State. Everybody, probably like a lot of you guys, everybody in your school went to Penn State, did not want to go. And I was good. I was a good runner, ran cross country as a freshman, was number 2. But it was just too small. And I realized, and I knew a lot of people went to Penn State, guys on the cross country team. And I decided to come to Penn State against my better judgment, but it turned out to be my best judgment.
So, real quick, I learned that when I was looking at your resume. You were like a sick runner.
I was pretty good. My PR is 25, 36 for 5 miles. I ran in the first Keystone State Games. Ran Boston Marathon. Actually, ran Boston Marathon when I was your guy's age. When I was a college junior, I qualified and ran Boston. So ran for most of my life.
And you did it in 2 hours and 48 minutes. Do I have that right? What was that like? Running the Boston Marathon.
It was awesome. 2 months. I qualified 2 months before in Allentown with a 2:46, and I then ran two marathons in 2 months. I was out after 20 miles. I was running 6-minute miles, and then hit the wall. Everything else, but it was really cool. I mean, it was great.
Your dad was a high school football coach, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. You've told me that, I think.
Yeah, my dad was a high school football coach. A lot of places, Milton Hershey. You guys heard of Milton Hershey High School, Eastern Lebanon, Camp Hill. My dad literally died in the locker room. He retired, was coaching his alma mater and mine, Palmyra High School. They had a rivalry game with Hershey. Everybody knows Hershey. They lost. The coach of Hershey was one of his former players. They clean up the locker room. Everybody's going home on a Friday night. He has a heart attack and dies.
Oh, my God.
So he lived and died for football, literally.
Wow. Oh, that's crazy.
But it's what he did. You know, it's a cliche, but he was doing what he wanted to do.
Right. That's a good point.
So anyway, I grew up, football was part of my life as a kid.
Did you play at all?
I did. I was a 125-pound wishbone quarterback with a single bar playing JV football. It's amazing. It's amazing I didn't make a career. But when they started falling left and right, the press box, I have eligibility, and I know how to hand off. I figured, hell, I could have gotten a win against Iowa. That's all you needed.
I am not kidding. Yeah. Would they have heard you on the snap count, or no? You would have been loud enough, you think?
I would have been a silent count.
Oh, yeah, true. Yeah, good point.
What was your time at Penn State like as a student, and do you have any favorite memories?
It was freaking awesome. I loved it. I was on the Collegian. You guys know I'm a huge fan of Onward State, and you guys this year are just killing it. I mean, it's just like you're great. But there was only the Collegian back then and a little bit of a radio station. So it was neat. So I covered football for 3.5 years. It was great great on the beat. There weren't many people. So that's my biggest memory. And we were only, Penn State now has 40 some undergrads. It was 24,000. So it was much smaller. So I had great memories of Penn State.
You are not our first Collegian alum that we've had on the show. We've also had Tom Verducci, I believe. Lisa Salters was also Collegian. So.
I think at one point,
Verducci
yeah.
and I were on the staff together.
Yep.
And if you're listening, Tom, I know that you hate me. He hate me. This is why we both were assistant sports editor, and Paula Froke got elected editor, and she could pick her sports editor. This is a true story.
Okay.
She could pick her sports editor, and Tom and I were both assistant sports editors, and he's a fabulous talent. I mean, look, right? He's the best sports journalist in America. You could say that. But she did the right thing, and she picked me to be Collegian sports editor. And so, Tom, that's my claim to fame. I beat out Tom for Collegian sports editor.
And you have another story with Verducci, right? Didn't you guys miss a flight at some point together?
We did. Yeah. We were like, and it's like we didn't drive like Onward State.
Yeah, no,
we actually flew to a game at Missouri.
I wish.
And we missed our flight the next morning. So we go to the airport. It's a little podunk airport, and we get there. It's a chain linked fence, and we see our plane taking off, and we're like, no. And it takes off. So we rented a car and drove. It was either Kansas City or St. Louis, so we could meet our flight. It was Tom, me, and a photographer. So yeah, we shit our pants. So, yeah.
And the game was in Nebraska. Sorry.
No, the game was in Missouri.
Oh, Missouri.
It was actually the first start. Todd Blackledge's first start. Go. But yeah, so yeah, so we covered. I mean, Tom is a fabulous talent. I mean, obviously, still is. A little stiff, but he's a good guy.
We friend of the show, Tom Verducci. Little shout out. We're driving to Tampa.
I drove the Sugar Bowl, man, in 82.
Hell yeah. I'm excited. We have a Ryan Parsons in the room with me, or with all of us. We've got a good plan. We can talk about it. We can talk about it off the air, but we have a good plan for how we're going to
get your road trips are epic. I mean, I love following the pictures. I'm stopping to see a friend. Is he a friend of the show? Drew Allar? I mean,
yeah.
Kind of, yeah.
He's a friend of the site. He's just my friend.
just your friend.
We would love to get
I thought I
pod.
Saw you in that picture with James and everybody last night. You were at the end, but you were in
James
there.
James and I, we had a beer after, but, you know, we're tight.
You know, I have a James beer story, by the way. Do you want to hear that?
Yeah.
Is, you know, James is talking about, you know, let's have a beer, right? Everybody's hearing it. Well, you wrote the fabulous story about it, Ryan. But I had dinner with James one time. It was just the two of us, and he didn't order a beer.
How'd that come up?
It was after the 2015. Great question, Jack, Sam. It was after 2015 season, and they shit in their hat two seasons in a row, 14 and 12. And he was losing the players, and he lost the media. He almost lost his job. So he went on a tour that summer, like to, you know, like a listening tour. And so we had dinner at Legends Pub at the Penn Stater.
Okay.
And then Chris Peterson called and said, James wants to have dinner with you, and he wants you to pick. And, like, I didn't want to pick because that's a power play. It's like, right. You know, you pick. So a couple years prior to that, O'Brien and I had dinner at Whiskers Pub in Legends. So I, same time in July, at in the Penn Stater. So I thought it'd be cool, to, the symmetry of having dinner of just Bill and I and then James and I at Legends Pub was cool. So we had it, and he didn't drink a beer. I mean, he was like, but I know James drinks. And then a couple years later,
what
he
do you think he drinks?
I think James is a
hard seltzer.
Yeah, I think. Well, not hard seltzer. I think James is, you know, stiff drink kind of guy. I think James. Yeah,
martini, olives, maybe.
Yeah, I think. Yeah, I think. I would think James is probably a gin and tonic or Jack
martini
and ginger
or something.
You know.
I can see that.
Yeah, but then a couple years ago, I wrote something and tweeted he didn't like, and like, it was a big fight.
What was it?
It was. You want to know?
I do.
It was February 19, and it was the second. This is a long story, but I think it's a good one. I like it. It was February of 19, and it was the presser after the second recruiting signing date. And I asked James, I go, you know, if you started today, who would your starting quarterback be? Who would be number one in the depth chart? And that's when Stevens was out with a foot injury. And James said Tommy Stevens. And Tommy deserved it. So fast forward the blue-white game, Tommy didn't play. Right? He was still rehabbing because he got a shit show of a surgery done, and then they tried to fix it. And so they asked James. I didn't ask James that day. Is Tommy the starting quarterback? And he like, I don't know. And then Ronnie said, I don't know. So like, I wrote my story and go like, from February to April, James told me this, and now he's not saying this. And then I tweeted it, and James was pissed. He sent me 7 DMs that weekend after my story came out. But it's a true story, so I'm okay. So I text Chris Peterson and go, tell James to stop DMing me. I get it. He wasn't happy with the story. So then I reached out to him, and then after classes were over, we went downtown, and we had breakfast at the Waffle Shop to kind of make peace. And I go in, and it's early in the morning, and it's like the Godfather. James is in the back. You guys know the Waffle Shop downtown, right? So he's in the back, and the booths are like this small. And James is in the back corner, far booth. He's already there early, okay? And then I'm going to circle back to our dinner, because I have a funny story to finish that. So he's there, and he's sipping this little espresso thing. It's like, we're having frickin' breakfast. So I order breakfast, and he gets another little espresso thing. It's like, really, we're having breakfast. But it was nice. We had a good conversation, and we made peace. So, you know, we're kind of frenemies. So anyway, at the end of the luncheon, at the end of dinner at Legends, right before the end, I get up to go to the bathroom, but I give our waitress, who didn't recognize James, by the way, no one in the whole restaurant except the maitre d', no one knew who James was. It was kind of funny. I thought it was funny because James loves that shit, right? He loves being recognized. And so I get up to go to the bathroom, but I slip my card to our waitress and pay the tab, which is the way to do it, right?
Yeah.
He may make he can make millions. You can leave that in. He makes millions, and I make whatever I make. But it's a power play. And so she comes over with the little, you know, the little padfolio with the thing, and she gives it to me, and James reaches for it. He goes, that's mine. And she goes, no, he already got it. And James goes, that's my move. So for me, and I paid for Obi too. So for me, I have those two receipts tacked on my bulletin board kind of as a reminder that I bought both of those guys dinner. And for me, the symmetry of having those one-on-one with both guys at different times, I think it gives has given me insight. And I've gone drinking with – you're a Bullsburg guy. I went drinking with Obi and at Duffy's, which is a different –
Yeah, he was my neighbor.
Yeah. So, but anyway, for me, but the symmetry of having dinner with both of those guys, for me, that's been kind of the neat thing to get to know these people a little bit more. I mean, I would never write about it, and even that, I've never written about me grabbing the check from James, but it just, I love that shit.
Do you, I know Sam has a follow-up, but do you remember what James ordered for dinner, or no?
He didn't order a beer, and it was like some, I have it, I should go look it up. It's yeah. like some club sandwich, I don't know, just... Something yeah. boring, you
yeah.
know?
Yeah.
So,
Obi pounded beers, man.
Say, yeah.
Oh, we were at, you've been to Duffy's, right?
Of course.
Been
yeah.
to Duffy's. Love and Duffy's.
Ever. Great, yeah. great little bar.
The little chickens running around.
So we go there. It's the off week. I like these stories. It's the off week. Penn State beats Michigan four overtimes,
sure.
right? And it's an off week before they play Ohio State. Penn State's never riding higher. So we go out, we meet the off week, and we meet at Duffy's. And Nate Bauer from Blue White was joining us. Bill and Nate got along really well. And so we get there, and it's like, and Obi's in his sweats. And Duffy's is a labyrinth of all these rooms from this colonial house. And so I go, well, let's just go back here. And he goes, this isn't a fucking meeting. We're going to the bar and drinking. So he That's puts awesome. Himself at the end of the bar. He's in his sweats, and he pulls out this big chunk of money with a rubber band around it. No pretensions or anything. And we drank all night. He must have had 8 Coors Lights. And people came up, and he took their pictures. It was but for me, it was great. I got a sense of what the guy's like. And I got to tell you, he was 98% the same guy sitting at the end of the bar at Duffy's that he was with everything else. And for me, that's all I want. Is just be off. I don't care who you are. Just be who you are.
That says a lot.
So my story about that is I met James Franklin for the first time at a Penn State hockey game. He was there, whatever. I was 12, 14. I was 14.
Wow.
And I, whatever, he was there with the security and all the, everyone was like, oh, it was like right when he was introduced. I went up, I shook his hand, I took a picture with him. It was cool. I mean, I grew up here. I grew up a Penn State fan, like you know. And it was just like kind of weird because growing up in the town with Joe Paterno, it was like no one was really taking pictures with him. No one was like going up asking for his autograph because he was around. You saw him.
Right.
There, he's never had security or anything. Bill O'Brien one time, they had just had a noon game, and it was over break, so it was like the Thanksgiving game. Bill went to the hockey game that night with his sweats on, like you said, and his hat kind of half on, sticking up to the side. He's sitting up the last row in the student section at the hockey game. There's no one there, but they put him up on the Jumbotron. They had just had a game. They won. Congratulations on the win, Coach O'Brien. Whatever. Thanks for coming to our game. He was just sitting there. He went like this. No one was going up, taking pictures with him. No one was going asking for autographs and stuff. Just like you said, that's just like who he is, and we're going to get into that later, but like, that was just interesting.
It's true. I mean, I think there's some special law when someone shows, what is it? When someone shows you who they are, believe them?
Yeah.
What is that? That's that Occam's razor?
Jeez.
Yeah, I don't know what
I actually don't
about.
Know that. But
okay.
You mean just being like.
It's the
like,
same.
Like you already said it. Like Bill was like 90%, like him
it was genuine.
At the end of the ball.
Yeah,
was,
they
yeah,
show
yeah,
who
genuine.
You are, show
yeah,
who you are.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
I used to teach this class. For 4 years, every fall, Joe Paterno Communications in the Media. Mm-hmm. And the first assignment kids had to do was write a paper on any personal interaction with Joe. Okay? And if you didn't, at least give me your perception of, because we needed a starting point of what you thought of this person. And then we talked about speeches and fundraising, and I brought in, like, the publisher of Sports Illustrated, talked about their brand and Joe's brand. And, like, I used the excuse to bring people in. But the point of the story is, it's like 40% of the kids in the class every year had a story with Joe with a one-on-one interaction.
Right.
And it just wasn't Joe doing a lap around downtown 3 times so people could see who he was. My favorite was there was a girl, a woman, who wrote about she was at Wegmans. And Joe came over and asked her where the frozen peas were. It's like, how down to earth is that?
Right.
You know, I mean, and that's essentially who Joe was. Like, where are the peas?
Yep.
you ever have interaction with Joe like you did with Bill? And like, did you have a personal relationship with him? You go out to dinner or anything?
No, with dinner with Joe. For I was a buddy.
Tom told us a story about how Joe used to host the media, and they would get to know the media. And Audrey's told these guys about how Bill O'Brien had a similar thing, and James teases about the beers in the basement. But
no,
that's
Joe had
a thing
on the road every Friday night. I've been to those, but I think Town and Gown still does it. For 25 years, I did a Penn State football magazine, preseason magazine, starting in 84. And I would do a sit-down with Joe, just him and me. And I did that for 22 straight years. I would go in and sit down with Joe, just him and me, which was a great experience. And when I started in the Collegian, the midweek press conferences were like eight people around a table. So it was face-to-face. So, yeah, I mean, I remember, a sophomore at Penn State through when he died. I mean, ended up teaching a class about him.
Right.
And Joe was very authentic. I mean, it was like the first year I taught sports writing here, when we started sports writing in the Curley Center, we went over to the media room where the press conferences were, and I had arranged in advance for Joe to talk to the students afterwards in the bowels of Beaver Stadium. So Joe does his presser on Tuesday. He comes out. And I follow him quickly so he didn't forget. And does anybody know Phil Gross that used to own Blue White Illustrated?
I don't know him, but.
He gets up to come out. And I go, Phil, sorry, this is just for the students. You're not in class. And Joe goes, well, you ought to be. And afterwards, Joe talked to the kids. He was great about that. I mean, he was of the campus.
Yeah. I mean, I remember I grew up, you said you're good friends with Jay. I grew up with his kids. Joey's one of my best friends in the world. I remember we used to play basketball, OLB hoops together, and Joe used to come to the games, and I remember it used to be like, I was always like, oh, there's Joe Paterno, but it was never like, oh my gosh, there's Joe Paterno, like I see people do with Franklin.
My dad's favorite story is after, I think, in like the, I don't know when, what year it would have been, but they had a big upset win, and this used to happen a few times, but they tossed the uprights over and then carried the uprights to his front yard. That's pretty awesome. Because he just lived, he was on like Park Avenue,
Sunset. Same house where Sue lives.
Yeah, right.
Sue lives now. No.
Just stuff like that, yeah.
Now, this might be one of my favorite, this is near the end of his career. There's a guy named Ryan Hockensmith, who wrote for the Collegian, writes for ESPN.
Got it.
If you Google him, he contracted spiral meningitis when he was covering a away game for the Collegian. He ended up going in a coma. He had part of his feet amputated.
Oh my God.
And Joe reached out, and Joe was very supportive of him. And there was nothing in it for Joe. But years later, and then Ryan was my intern, and he's still one of my best friends. Years later, Ryan won a university award, and part of my alumni job is arranging visits and making that stuff happen. So I reached out to Joe and said, hey, Ryan's coming in. Can he come over to the office or whatever? And, like, I wasn't in the office, but Joe called me back and goes, hey, I'm calling to figure out when is a good time for Ryan to come to practice or my office. And he's going like, we can do Tuesday at 2 or Wednesday at this. And this is like in 2008 or something. Like, Joe's calling, it meant so much to him about hooking up with Ryan, seeing Ryan and making it work, that he just called himself. And I can't imagine the current guy doing that.
What was it like covering the team with Joe Paterno?
You know, Wednesdays, I think pressers were Wednesdays. When I was a student?
Yeah.
Pressers were Wednesday. They were out at Toftree's. He had quarterback club at Toftree's, and then the media after that. And there was only like 8 or 10 people in the media then. And you literally sat around a conference table. And we would spend all day practicing what our questions were, because if you didn't have, if your question, like, it's from me to Sam, it's Joe, you know, and it, you can even think now people get frightened. Now you guys do a good job, and Mikey always was really good with questions.
Yeah, he was. Questions. Shout out Mikey
Mander. Yeah, Mikey was really good. So you had to practice. It was a great experience for me though. It's like you're asking Joe a question. I got right here every week. So you had to be ready as a student journalist. It was great because, like, if it was a stupid question or you weren't prepared, he'd let you know. You know, it was So it was good. It was good. It was good training. The other thing is that campus was much smaller, and I think it's different now. It's like you guys know the players, and you might have a class with Cliff or Dotson, but you don't know them. But it was half the size. Like, I knew the guy that I was covering. I remember I wrote a story one time for the Collegian, and we were in the Carnegie building, and I came out, and there's there's Mark D'Onofrio. I don't know, that name rings a bell. Big, tough linebacker, used to coach at Miami.
Gotcha.
And, like, he threatened to beat me up for something I wrote in the Collegian because he knew him. And then another time, Harry Hamilton was an All-American safety. We had a poli-sci class together. He was academic All-American. So I'm at my apartment, and I get this call. And I go, "Oh, Mike." And I go, "Yeah." He goes, "This is Harry Hamilton." I go, "Yeah?" He goes, "I wasn't in class in eight because I broke my nose." And it's like, and it's a phone call. It's a regular conventional phone call. "Can I borrow your notes?" You know, you just can't imagine a guy in the team now calling up Sam and go, "I busted my nose in practice. Can I have your notes?" Which is different. You know, it's easier. You know, but also it's more personal. So if you fucked up or you had a bad question, it's like, they're on you, man.
On kind of on that note, especially like with Joe, were you kind of a random one, but were you there? I know there's like a famous clip of it was towards the end of his career when you guys, when they were in Alabama. I forget who asked the question. He got
Brennett. Brennett was great.
I don't know.
He should have guessed. It was great. He was all over Mark.
It was about analyzing Rob Bolden's play, I think. I think Connor's right.
But yeah, no, it was yeah.
Like,
it was,
you saw it. You tell
just,
me. I don't know.
Just yeah.
Got
it was
anything
just,
else to ask?
It was just classic. Like, and then when
then he got up and left. Didn't he walk off?
Yeah, he was pissed. Yeah. And then some other woman was like, it was like a Southern reporter. She's like, "Did you like Alabama, coach?" And he was like, "Yeah, I liked it."
That is a classic one. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have any other funny stories about covering him? You covered Joe for – when did you start?
Well, my first game was 79.
Wow.
So you covered Joe for 30
years.
A
long, long time, yeah. I enjoyed it. Joe was tough. Joe was legit. Joe was smart. Like, for a presser, Joe would tell you a story. You get an anecdote. He wouldn't, like, go, "Well, it's a combination of things," you know? It's like, I get it.
It's you all
know, of it. Obviously. You know, Joe would tell you a story from – 30 years ago, that actually was relevant if you paid attention. I enjoyed that. But it's different. You know, I think for me, as an old guy on the beat now, it's like I still keep in touch with Obie. Like, we were texting a lot this fall with Alabama and what's going on here, or Moorhead yesterday with the job. It's like John Donovan. And there were a lot of good guys. Like, I'm still going to criticize them. When I write, I mean,
it's your job.
Yeah, I do that. You guys know that. But also, the fact that I was an adult and someone that they would see from year to year. So I with keeping those relationships has been kind of cool. And then rooting for them, like I was for Michigan, man. Josh Gattis is a good guy. Like I was psyched for him
for sure.
You got to text Bill O'Brien, tell him to come on our show.
Yeah, honestly.
Bill
yeah.
O'Brien, I always say, and we'll get into Bill O'Brien in a sec, but Bill O'Brien, I always say, is I go Bill, Joe, Franklin. And it's just like, that's my hierarchy. Bill O'Brien was so important.
Bill and James were on the same staff together at Maryland.
I didn't know
that.
Yeah.
Because was James... He wasn't offensive coordinator yet, was he?
No.
He was like a wide receivers coach.
Wide receivers
they were, yeah, they lived down the street from each other.
There you go. Oh,
that's so interesting.
It's funny how all those connections work.
Yeah, I'll tell you a story when we're done.
That can be an off-the-record thing. What was Bill, did he talk to you about the bunch of fuckers moment? Remember that?
Oh, yeah. No, of course he said it. No, he was a big swear. One of my favorite Bill stories is on a Sunday morning, I was going into campus, and Bill flew by me right by Myers Dairy. Okay, you know where Myers Dairy is, right? And you know where Bill lived, right?
Yeah. Well,
and he flew by me and then turns up University Drive. Like, and so my story, like Colin and I was like, you know, Bill was rushing to the office early at 8:30 on Sunday morning to put the offense together because they sucked yesterday. Like, you know, I could write. I didn't say suck, but I could write that. And so like on Tuesday's presser, he finishes up. And he gets up to walk off, and he points to me. He goes, "Hey, Poorman." He goes, and I said, he must be going to church. No, and I said, no, he's going to the office because he has to start working on the offense. And he turns, he goes, "No, Poorman, I was going to church, and I wasn't speeding." You know, so for me that was great that he read my
Church
stuff.
He could take my criticism,
and he was still funny about it. You know, that to me is like the ultimate of, and it also shows they all read your stuff. They read your stuff.
We just came up on 10 years of since the scandal. What was it like covering the team during that? We had last week on Derek Moy, who was captain during that season. We've had plenty of players that were either in the program during that time, Bill Belton, Jordan Hill, or people that, you know, came up right afterwards. And they all have very interesting stories, but we haven't had anyone that was part of the beat or part of the media during that time. So what was kind of your memory of that whole situation?
Well, I wore a lot of hats. So I'm teaching Paterno Communications and the Media Tuesday morning, 9 a.m. in Carnegie Cinema, okay, during the scandal. Covering the team for statecollege.com. Jay then is now is one of my best friends. And I was advisor for what was then Paternoville.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
Yeah. For a number of years, I was, and then I actually, and then the next summer, changed the name to Deville, and I was advisor for another year. So that's just four things, you know, that were my, it was like my world overlap. It was really, really nuts. Like that Tuesday morning in class, our guest was Sarah Ganim.
Damn.
Like, that's a good guest for class,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, and then she broke the whole story.
She broke the story.
Yeah.
Penn State grad.
Yeah.
And that Thursday, that Wednesday night, Joe got fired. And I found out that they were having the thing. Jay called me and said, go over there. They're having a thing. And I'm waiting outside of the Dean's Hall with all the media to go in. I get a text from Jay and goes, they just fired Joe. So I knew what was happening. And he didn't know whether he had a job. So I knew that. And I had just come from Paternoville to check on those guys. So it was nuts. But like, and then so class on Thursday morning of scandal week was Pat Forty. You guys know Pat Forty?
I don't think so.
Pat Forty writes for Sports Illustrated. He wrote for Yahoo.
Okay.
He's still one of the top five college football guys. And Joe Posnanski, who wrote a bio of Joe at the time, he was a Sports Illustrated.
Pat, who wrote the bio?
Joe Posnanski.
Oh, okay.
And he was in town working on the. So we went to breakfast, and then they came to class that Thursday. So that week, I had Joe's biographer, Pat Forty from Yahoo, and Sarah Ganim just as guests that week in class. So, and then I was on Aaron Burnett later that week for CNN. Yeah. So that, I mean, it was like, and for you're asking about the beat, but for class, it's like. USA Today came when Steve, you guys know Steve Manuel?
Yes.
Steve came 1 week during the week after scandal and talked about Crisis Com, and that was in the paper. New York Times came. Fox did a special on the class. The New Yorker, I mean, every class I would show up and there'd be all these media, and Penn State was being guilty of not being transparent, right? Mm-hmm. So it was like, sure, anybody wants to come to class? And so it was a 60-person class and 125-seat auditorium, but then everyone started coming to class.
Right.
So it was just, it was nuts. I mean, I wasn't sleeping. I mean, because I was wearing all, it was just incredible.
How did Penn State feel about that? How, like, what was going on with your class? You know what I mean? Because it kind of became like you can't replicate that experience. I mean, it was crazy, right? Like those few months having,
it was a place to go. Now the assistant dean came to class once or twice to see what I was talking about. Twitter was alive. Onward State, Devin Edwards,
yep,
right?
Yep.
I had Devin in class. So he was tweeting his little brains out during class. No, I mean, it was like they did.
Shout out.
Penn State's credit, they didn't say, don't talk about this.
Oh, okay.
But whether I'm writing Sam now or whether I was teaching then, I try to rely on the facts. And what I know to be true. So a lot of my stuff I write is fact, research-based, but then also bring in guests.
Sure.
If I can bring in guests that can talk about things that I can or I don't know. So I had a lot of I mean, one of my best friends, he lives in Bowlesburg. Shout out Scott Etter. You might know his kids.
I do very well. Yeah.
Yeah. So Scott's business is he's an attorney for school solicitors. So he was, I'm not talking about school, he was a school solicitor for Central Mountain. So the superintendent went to Scott and said, hey, we have this complaint against Jerry Sandusky. What should we do? And Scott will tell you, and he did. And Scott came to class and told the whole story and said, you got to report it. And then Scott told that story for class, but then he also then shared, okay, this is what's going on. This is what reporting means. These are the legal obligations. So for me, I kept on bringing in guests who could share that insight that I didn't have.
What are some of your takeaways 10 years later?
If Penn State had been last behind Ohio State, behind Michigan, behind Michigan State, it wouldn't be the deal that it was. And I'm not, there were victims, and I'm not saying that. But I'm just saying, you know, Nassar had cast of thousands, right? So if Penn State was at the end of the line instead of the first, it wouldn't have been as prominent. And then also because Joe was involved. If it hadn't been Joe, I remember to get ready for class, the first class, scandal week, class was Tuesday morning, and all the satellite trucks and TV trucks were lined up between the BJC and Beaver Stadium, like tons of them. Mm-hmm. Like, was freaking wall to wall. And I was getting ready to go to class, and we were going to talk about the coverage. And I stop and talk to these people, and they all go like, what are you doing? What's the goal? Who's your audience? How long are you staying? And they all said, we're not leaving until Joe's gone. Like, they said that Monday night.
The national media said
that. The national
that, like,
media.
CNN
they were
stuff,
waiting for
yeah.
Joe to get fired. And so it became about Joe. And one of my... And I used this part in class. So a lot of this we talked about in class, takeaway 10 years ago. It's still about Joe. It's not about Jerry. One of my best friends owns Rapid Transit. Shout out Terry Losh, RTS, Allen Street. And Terry said to me, he goes, everyone's at Joe's. Who's at Jerry's house? And so I drove out to Jerry's house. No one was. Well, there was one truck there. There was one truck that was a repair truck because someone had thrown a rock through one of Jerry's windows and they were repairing it. But so I used that in class.
Yeah.
So I said, I took pictures and said, here's where Jerry lives. Here's where Joe lives. The media are all at Joe's house. There's no media at Jerry's house. So for me, then as in now, was about Joe and not Jerry. But that's how I would try to incorporate it. Let's talk about the media and where the story is and why they're covering that. So 10 years later, it's still about Joe. It's not about Jerry.
That's something I wanted to follow up on, that note about the national media, because we were actually, my whole family and I, Charlie, my brother Charlie is here as well. We were at the
love the tweets of Charlie and the family.
There you go.
Your mom
yeah.
was so proud when you came home.
Exactly.
Happy
yes,
you came home for
they were.
She's like, she surprised you're home for break.
But, yeah, so we had bought tickets to that Nebraska game, like, before the season. My dad is a Penn State alum, so we were going to that game. But so I remember that very well, like, all the national media trucks and stuff. I was only, like, 11, so I didn't fully, I guess, grasp it. But I do, like, all, like, CNN, every national outlet was in front of Old Main. But so, like, your note about you taking the ride out to Jerry's house and, like, getting that side of the story, do you feel like that was, like, the difference between local media and national media? Like, you had an advantage in that way, kind
of?
Oh,
huge advantage, yeah. But, I mean, they didn't know. I mean, so when I was on Aaron Burnett's show, I went to Jack Harper and bought a new scarf because it was an outdoor shot. And it's like she goes, and she's on CNN, and she goes, like, well, Jerry Sandusky must have beat it out of town. I go, no, actually, he was at Sears today buying a treadmill because they won't let him in Lash anymore.
Holy shit.
To work out.
Wow.
And it's not the narrative they wanted to hear,
yeah.
but it's the local knowledge. So, yeah, Jerry's not out of town. So, yeah, I mean, it was... So,
yeah.
In that sense, class was very good as far
for
as...
For sure. No, that's very interesting.
Did you expect, when you first heard about, you know, the rumors and stuff, did you expect it to be as big of a deal as it was? Did you expect Joe to get fired? Did you expect Joe to be, you know, the whole free report and everything that ended up resurfacing? Did you expect all of that? Or did you think it was going to be like a little thing that it would be over? Did you think that 10 years later we would still be hearing stuff about it? Which, granted, it has died down to the point where a lot of students here don't really know what happened. But
yeah, to Grace's question, I to answer yours, I don't think there was not the big 10-year anniversary thing. I expected more of that. And I didn't expect the big thing with Joe. But two pieces to that. I remember the blue-white game the year before. Someone who I know who's an embedded local said that they're investigating this, and watch out, it's going to be bigger than what you think. Okay? And so that was actually a year and a half out. And then in March, Sarah Gannon broke the first story that the grand jury is investigating this. And I remember I taught sports writing then, and we spent class the next day reading those two stories and breaking them down and talking about the ramifications and seeing where it fit. And I thought it was a big story. And it turned out to be not that huge because Penn State didn't have a ready plan for it. And they didn't kick Jerry out of using Lash or anything else. So I don't think anybody knew it was going to blow up like this. But there were enough telltale signs that no one thought it was going to blow up like this.
So you heard that rumor and then...
A year and a half before it would have been sort of been like April of 2010.
Or 2010.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is crazy. So, and then, I guess, you didn't like forget about it, but that you kind of, did you think it would like come up?
No, again? and then in March of 2011, Gannon said there is a grand jury presentment.
Right.
And then I'll be honest with you, at the time, two of my friends worked for Second Mile, and they had a sense it was... By that point, they had kept Jerry away from being involved in the Second Mile. So they had a sense it was going to be big.
Yeah.
What would you say were the main differences between... I mean, Penn State has had three coaches in almost nearly 100 years.
Tommy Bradley would say four.
Four. Fair enough.
He beat Ohio State, to his credit, 2011.
Penn State's had three coaches, four including Tom Bradley, but three mainly... in nearly 100 years, Joe Paterno, Billy O'Brien, James Franklin. What would you say are the big three differences between them? Knowing, I would say, all of them personally, but also as far as football.
Yeah, I know James the least best, which is kind of funny. It's 8 years, but I think that's that's a great question. I think all three of them really, and sometimes he doesn't always show it, James, but they really love this place. And I will tell you, the people, this, I'm going to answer your question a different way, a little bit. But people who were here coaching and left, they all say Penn State's the best place to be, you know. And I fervently believe this. I think they all appreciate how terrific it is, whether it's white out or going for a walk downtown or a beer at Duffy's or whatever. Especially now when you look at the coaching carousel.
Mm-hmm.
I think all of them, and they all understood how important football is here. I mean, I'm telling you anything you don't know. But it's incredibly important. I could go a lot of ways with that question. It's just they're all very different, you know. They all got in the business for different reasons. I'll answer. And I have to tell you though, I used to before in my early in my career, I had magazines, football magazines. Army, Air Force, Navy, Notre Dame, Syracuse, Michigan, Michigan State. Like, I've been to all those places and did magazines and covered them. But Penn State's different, you know. Penn State is different. And I will tell you this is making this about me. Having the opportunity to be here that long and cover the program that long with those three guys, but then all the other people that are part of it. I mean, it's without being corny, it's a huge blessing. And honestly, for me, like this season, like with the Onward State guys, Gabe and Will and Ryan, it was energizing to me. It's fun. And I learned, I mean, I learned a lot from you guys. And so for me, 43 years later, I'm still blessed to be able to do it, not just covering James, but it's like, you know, whether it's fucking Verducci or Pegs, it's like the same thing, you
oh,
know?
That is such a good line. Sorry.
It is. It's a great opportunity, and I'm really lucky to be able to do it in a place where football matters, and football matters in a way in that you're not, you don't operate it as a bad actor in running the program.
Well, thank you very much for saying that.
Sure.
That was a great answer. But
we do appreciate when you said, when you sent out that tweet,
oh, it's true.
You know what tweet I'm talking about?
Yeah.
When you sent out that tweet, the four of us were very, that meant a lot.
Oh, yeah, it's been great. For me, I'll look back in the season, it's one of the best things for this season. I learn a lot from you guys, you know.
Right,
but it's also, you also make it fun, you know.
Sure.
And you have to have fun on the me for the beat, you know, you guys and Audrey, you know, there's a couple people that I just and even like Greg Kincaid, who's the sports information guy for Penn State, I really enjoy him. I think he does a good job. And for me, I'm kind of lucky. It's not my full-time job.
Right.
So I make a couple bucks, but I want to have fun doing it.
Well, we appreciate you. We appreciate you saying
that. Yeah, very much. One of the other very cool things you get to do, though, you mentioned it, you are the, I want to get it, make sure I get this right, I am sorry, Director of Alumni Relations for the College of Comm. So what do you do? Like, what do you do? What's your role in that?
We have a couple boards. We do events. I mean, it's like, we did a thing, I was just telling someone the other day, like in L.A., this was just, it was canceled right before the pandemic, but we were going to do an event with arts and architecture. One of our alums is high up at Netflix. We were going to do an event on the rooftop of Netflix, overlooking the Hollywood sign at sunset with 200 Penn Staters having this big cocktail party. It's like, that's great. You know, I've had events at the New York Times and UCLA and, you know, cool places all over where alumni at. Like, a couple years ago, we did a TED Talk in L.A., and Michael Robinson was one of the people doing the TED Talk, or Jonathan Frakes, who does Star Trek.
Mm-hmm.
Doing neat stuff like that, it's a business. Like, it wouldn't be as much fun if it was Earth Mineral Science. Like, they're freaking boring, no offense. But it's calm. It's media people.
Sure.
You know, it's you get to meet those people. You get to involve those people. You get to engage those people. I mean, it's, you know, for me, that's the cool. It's that cool business to involve those people. It's like, usually every fall, we take a group of SPJ, Society of Professional Journalists, to New York City. And they go to, and it's like a dozen students, but we'll go see alum at Good Morning America or Today Show or the NFL or ESPN or AP to do all that kind of stuff. It's great. It involves the alums, great opportunity for students. And so doing those type of things, it's a cool, you know, it's a cool business. Our people do need stuff.
You big into travel?
That's one of the neat things about the up until this, I love traveling. Yeah. Yeah.
It said on your resume, 41 states,
11 countries. Yeah.
What states have you not been to? I actually have you beat. I got 42 states.
Gee, really?
Damn, I didn't know that.
Wow.
What states
do you
not have?
You know, Alaska and Hawaii, Montana. I'll give you that's neat that you read that. My last trip overseas,
research, right?
Yeah, my last trip overseas was with the field hockey team for Penn State. I was their advisor, so they did an international tour of Holland, and I went along. And so that was a piece of Penn State that I got to know the women on the team and travel that. So for me, Penn State's a lot of those pieces that I get to do. So that travel's cool, you know, or going to a bowl game, or going to L.A. For countless stuff.
Who's the most famous person in your phone?
Wow. The most famous person in my phone. Probably, I don't really have. Don King, the director of Saturday Night Live.
Friend of the show.
Friend of the show. Oh, yeah. Don's a great guy.
When I emailed him, it was Sam's fault, actually. I asked him if he could come on our show on February 30th. That just, like, doesn't exist.
And then he
like, had to tell me, and I was like, I'm so sorry and embarrassed.
It was so much my fault.
But it went through both of us, so, like, I don't know how neither of us realized.
It was, yeah, it was mine.
Yeah, but lovely, I also didn't realize.
Lovely guy. I don't know. Linda Iaccarino, Penn State grad, who's head of NBC Universal Advertising.
Nice.
I think O'Brien's pretty famous.
I was just going to say, yeah. We should call O'Brien. No, I'm just kidding.
We, our group chat, the football beat, our group chat's called Bunch of F***ers.
Oh, that is great.
I think there's T-shirt. I'm going to get a T-shirt of that.
It's like my favorite Penn State moment of all. It's like one of my favorite Penn State moments of all time. Because it's like, I was there and I got home and I just remember like seeing it on SportsCenter or whatever. And we were just like, oh.
What?
I said fighter. That's so weird. Who's the most famous person you have?
Probably Katie Feeney. But her contact isn't actually saved. It's just, there's a message somewhere.
Yeah, I don't know. I would say most of the people, like the famous people, are through this.
Yeah. So, couldn't let you leave without asking about this year's football team. Obviously 7-5, we know now they're going to the Outback Bowl. What are some of your biggest takeaways from this season, if you could sum them up? It's a loaded question. I'm sorry.
It is a loaded question. I'm posting a story tonight that the 2018 recruiting class was ranked fifth in the country, right? Justin Sorter, Ricky Slade, Micah Parsons. This is the year they would have been seniors, right?
Yep.
So out of the 23 guys on that roster, out of the 23 guys who were on signing day, fifth. And I think this is germane for now because what is this? This next class coming in is sixth, and they're gonna. You know, I know it's Alar, friend of Onward State, but same kind of thing. And guess how? To those 23, how many were even on the roster this year?
You tell me. Not many.
Well, it's, I say guess, which means you come up with. You don't know, but you come up with a number.
I would say less than half. Yeah, no.
10.
Oh. I did guess 10, but you
and,
said
and like
time, but,
six of those are starters.
Right.
I mean, this.
Who are they? The six starters.
The starters. Well, you got you have Dotson. You had Mustafa. You had Lucetta. But then the guys that you don't have are Shorter and Slade.
Say, yeah.
And Owe and Parsons are gone.
Yeah.
And Zach Kuntz went to Old Dominion. By the way, Zach Kuntz was number two in the nation in catches by a tight end this year. Don't look at the recruiting class. Look at who ends up. And then they didn't have leadership. I mean, they didn't have leadership on the sidelines during games. What a shit show that was. And I don't have to go into that because everybody knows. But then, you know, the players didn't take the team by the horn and say, you know, fuck it, we're not going to lose, you know? They just didn't have any senior leadership.
Levis was in that class.
So Levis was in that class.
Balling at Kentucky now.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, you're looking up so you can see.
Yeah, I just have a bullet
Humphreys,
now.
Who
yeah.
sold,
yep.
who sued Penn State, was in that class.
Yep.
So, yeah, but I mean, it's like next year's not – I don't think next year's going to be much better.
Hmm. I don't think I disagree with you.
I mean,
we'll be gone.
Yeah.
You
I mean,
won't,
I'm still going to be watching.
I mean, that's not – my answer is not super insightful.
No, it was. That was an interesting point.
Are you surprised with Outback Bowl?
Oh, yeah. I think everybody's surprised.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, someone high up at Penn State, not James, texted me today and go, that's like, says a lot for the Penn State brand, right?
Well, that, absolutely. And also, I don't think that this team is necessarily as bad as the record shows. I mean, I feel like there was.
Oh, good. I think moral victories. So there's 7-2-3 moral victories.
He's right. I mean,
yeah.
I know Cliff said that too. You are what your record says you are. I don't care how you got there.
Right. What did they go? They went 7-5 in James's first year.
They went 7-6.
Seven and six. The Penn State Bowl win. Yeah.
So if they lose, they're 7-6 again.
Right.
You think Penn State would be better off without Franklin with a different coach coming in? They let Franklin go. They don't sign him 10 years. What do you think about the contract? They let him go.
It's really
they let him
walk. The contract's really only 6 years.
Right.
And it's really $8.5 million. It's not $7.5 million. Here's how it's $8.5 million. You get 650 base, and then you have 6.5 base, and then another 500. So that's you get seven. You have an insurance thing that you can cash in
for $1 million. That's eight. And the retention bonus every December 31st, that's real money. So it's all of a sudden 8.5. So it's really only 6 years, and it's 8.5, and it's really good for 2 years, maybe 1 year. After April 1st, it's $8 million, and next year, next January 1st, it's down to $6 million. We just saw what Miami paid now. Yeah. So it's at most a 2 year deal till Jimmy can leave if he wants.
Right. I think that was the interesting thing. Like, we could be, like, the first half of this position, of the season, we were in that position where every time he'd be like, you know, my past 8 years, my commitment to Penn State has been shown, but he answered it trying to, you know, get leverage or whatever that was.
I think for me, I thought it was the best question of the year.
Yeah.
It's like, why don't you come out and just say, I love it here and I'm staying.
Right.
And he goes, oh, I've already answered that. Exactly. Like, no, you haven't answered that.
So I think Penn State's going to be in that same position in like 3 years.
Oh, yeah, 2 years.
And you're referring to his buyout?
Yeah, his buyout.
It's going to be $1 million by 2026.
Yeah, but in 2 years, it's going to be $6 million.
Right.
And $6 million buyout's nothing. Let's say Penn State really does. Let's say Penn State goes 10-2 and 11-3. They're not, but then he is gonna leave unless they build him everything. But I think James did a fab. He was the right guy at the right time. And again, my story tonight, 16-17 was incredible. It was incredible. I don't think it's enough credit. And I wrote, that's the time he should have got the 10-year deal. But I don't think James wants to be here, because I have no problem saying I love Penn State and I'm gonna be here next year. How hard is that?
Yeah. It's true. It's a good point.
I mean, you see it with other coaches that stay. I mean,
yeah, Tomlin said it and Jimbo said it, and you know, I don't begrudge people leaving or getting money. I think that's fine, but don't go like, I've shown my commitment. You know, I know what he was doing. He's parsing his words.
What does that mean? He's shown his commitment. How? He's stayed. He's re-signed a couple times.
I mean, I don't think it means anything.
It's a empty statement.
Yeah.
But.
I mean, he was, anyway. Yeah. He did a fabulous job. 16-17 was terrific. Penn State really owes him, and now they're paying him.
Yeah.
Agreed. And here's the other piece. Look, there's a new president that's going to be announced in a couple weeks.
Who's it going to be, Mike?
I know you know.
Well, I know the three finalists.
Who are they?
I can't tell you that. And then Sandy has a year and a half to go on her contract. And if I'm Sandy, I want to keep my job and get $1.5 million a year for a couple more years before she retires. So the last thing she's going to do is to let James go, get a new coach in, and take that gamble of what it's going to be like, because then it'll fuck up her contract with the new president. So letting Jimmy ride is the easy thing for Barron and for her.
Fair enough.
So those are my takeaways of the contract and the deal.
Yeah.
Plus, here's the other thing. Penn State was number two last year in attendance in Beaver Stadium.
Right.
They're not going to rock the boat.
Right.
Well, I will guarantee you, though, if Penn State was in the playoffs, James would not be coaching Penn State next year.
Interesting.
I'm 94% sure on that.
If James leaves, what jobs are better than Penn State? If he were to choose to leave, what jobs would take him away from Penn State? And if James were to stay, but potentially be ousted or whatever, want to stay, but be ousted.
They're not going to do that. There's no way they could do that.
But if so, like, before this contract came, if James wanted to stay, but they didn't want him anymore, who's better than James? If they wanted to.
Like, well, that's a great question.
But who would be the replacement
It's a moot point, because if Penn State wanted to get rid of James, they can't. It's going to be next year. It's going to be $72 million.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is crazy.
I mean, and it goes $8 million a year. I mean, it's like, so who's better than James? It's two questions.
If they didn't,
what job
bring
is better than Penn State? Alabama's better.
You think USC is better? Well, that's all changed now.
I think USC is better, because here's why. It's like the Penn State's fourth in the East. They're fourth.
Yeah.
And maybe Penn State's better than Michigan State, but right now they're not better than Michigan or Ohio State. And here's the thing. The other thing about James getting the contract, they're betting that that the playoffs go to 8 and 12 teams. Mm-hmm. And then Franklin might be in. But USC, they're going to make the playoffs. If Lincoln Riley's any good, they're making the playoffs.
Because Pac-12, yeah.
Yeah, not only with four teams, but then 8 and 12
yeah,
teams.
Yeah, no doubt.
So, yeah.
So there is plenty of teams better. Like, Alabama's not realistic. Like,
they're
Nick
not gonna
Saban's
hire him.
Program.
But what I think is better now, and we saw it with Kelly, is LSU's better because you can get to the playoffs. Although I think he wore out his welcome. I think the best job now is what's going to get you the playoffs.
Do you see Kelly faking the Southern accent?
Oh, my God.
Family.
Wow, that was really good.
Yeah, oh, it was. I think it's been enjoyable to me to see how much everyone has trashed him once he left. Conversely, it's like, where were you guys trashing him the past 12 years,
right.
You know? I mean, it's like, it's easy to kick someone when they're not there anymore. I mean, I have to tell you, it's like, I think James did a fabulous job in a lot of ways, but I write critical stuff sometimes. And most people won't do that because they want to go to a press conference and they want James to like them, and he's not their buddy. The hard thing is to write hard stuff that's true stuff when someone's there, and then you go see them the next day. And a guy like Bill would get back to me and give me a hard fucking time, you know? That's why I respected him.
Yeah.
And to James' credit, yeah, he sent me 7 DMs and said, stop it. You know? But you have to be a big boy and take that stuff.
Who's your least favorite person on the beat?
My least favorite person on the beat?
No, I'm just kidding.
No, I was going to answer that.
Oh, who is it? Do you want to tell us after we're
done
recording?
Yeah, we don't have to record this if you don't want it, Mike.
Yeah, no, I have one.
Okay, we'll talk about it after.
But I will tell you my least favorite characteristic of the beat.
Yeah, let's hear
it. Two things. Is people that will be critical of James or whatever, but they won't ask the question. And then the other ones that are just fans. They're just let me give you a long. This is a long answer. The people on the beat that on their Twitter. What do you call that?
The header.
The header. They're headers of Beaver Stadium. It's like, it's your fucking Twitter page. You don't live at Beaver Stadium, okay? Maybe if you're Baker Mayfield, you put the Cleveland Stadium there. But it's the beat. If you show me two pictures of you on the beat, that's your identity. Get a fucking life.
So, Ben Jones.
There's a lot of people that do that. Drives me freaking nuts. Do you guys have that?
I'll show you. I think mine's a great picture of Old Main that I took.
Okay, well there you go.
And it's me, my brother.
Mine's me and
me
Mac Miller.
I don't know how you feel about that. But.
Mine, my bio says the home office, and it's a picture of my home.
What the fuck? How do I get to my account?
It's cool.
So that drives me nuts.
Yeah. So Ben Jones. Yeah. We'll cut that.
No, that's nice.
That's a great picture.
Yeah. I think it's a pro. Apropos, it's your Penn State's a nice picture.
Oh, our last question is: what are your words of wisdom for college students?
Do it all. Like the Indians say, you can rest when you're dead. Like, just go fucking balls the wall every single day. And even that means like a day where you don't do anything, like do it really fucking well. Drink a lot, order everything in, and just hang. And if you're gonna hang all day and blow everything off. But it's like, get in a fucking car and stop in Medina, Ohio, and interview Drew Allar. That to me is like, that is the best day.
It was a good day.
Yeah. And so for me, it's like, for me, the best thing is, I'm giving long answers. But for me is when I put my head on the pillow, and I'm lucky, my kids are all grown. I live alone. I put my head on the pillow at the end of the day and I go, I can't fucking believe all that happened today. You know, and for me, that's a great day.
That's awesome. That is very good advice.
Poorman, you're the greatest, dude.
Yeah, this is an awesome interview.
We we appreciate you spending so much time with us. We're going to let you go finish your story, but we really appreciate you hanging out with us. I, first of all, on the last episode, we were talking about bowls. Me, Will, Connor, I said, I want Vegas because I want to go to the Peep Show with Mike Poorman.
My in-laws used to live in Vegas.
Oh, there you go.
There we go. But I am very much so looking forward to having a drink with you in Tampa. We'll see you down
I'm
there.
I'm not sure I'm going, but if I do, you got it.
Shit. All right.
I mean, if I go with Com Radio, I'm going. Otherwise, I'm not.
Oh, well, we got to hold on to that radio.
Come with us. You can literally drive with us.
Well, maybe.
We're going to help
Jordan Mansberger's got you. I live with the GM. Lock that down.
I have to say, at the end, I think I alluded to this.
Not even a question. Jeez.
You the Onward State guys this year, it was one of my 43 seasons, one of my best seasons ever writing football, and it's because of you guys. Because whenever I would bump into you guys in the game, on the press box, on the field, or see you on Twitter or your freaking stories, it made me smile. It was like it was a great part. You guys have been a great part of my life, and it's not just because you're good guys, like. You're good writers. You do it well, and it's fun to read. And I really appreciate it.
We appreciate you, Mike. That's right. That we feel the same way. You were like a very much of a role model for us on the beat. So we very much appreciate that. No, seriously. You like your point about like having the balls to stand up for what you write, and if it's negative, ask a question about it. That's very good advice. So we very much appreciate you saying that.
Thanks,
Poorman. We appreciate you coming on. I'm looking forward to buying you a beer in Tampa.
If not, we'll go to Duffy's.
Sounds good.
You can do that, too. Thanks, Mike.
Sounds good. Appreciate it. Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Poorman.
Let's go. What a finale.
That was another episode of Podward State. We had Mike Poorman on for our season finale. What'd you think, Sam?
It was awesome. I love Poorman. Great guy. Said some wild stuff. Looking forward to talking to him again. Season 6 coming up. We hope everybody has a happy holiday, no matter what you celebrate. We hope that you celebrate it to the fullest.
Yeah.
And like Mike said, balls to the walls.
Every single day. You have to tell everyone to donate blood. You didn't do that yet.
Oh, yeah. Make sure that you donate some blood. Save a life. Connor needs a kidney. Appreciate you guys sticking around. Different Connor. Do you know that story? Okay, I'll tell it afterwards. appreciate you guys listening along. Season 5. See you season 6 for
what
the Grace Cunningham show.
If I don't kill it, which I could.
I really hope
I won't. I'm kidding. I won't do that.
No, I know.
But I could.
This has been another episode, another season of Podward State. My name is Sam Brungo.
I'm Grace Cunningham.
Take it easy, guys. Be safe.
Adios.
Happy holidays.
Done by you something.